Aye.
Aye. Aye. Oh, man, it seems like you need a little hoorah. So everybody's kind of like, hoorah. How's everybody doing today? Aye, still not good. Well, I'm not going to try to force you to be happy. But hey, at least we're at the house of God. Amen? Can you say amen? At least we're in the house of the Lord. At least that we're here with brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
At least we have a place and have freedom to worship God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so, regardless of how your week's been or how you maybe had this week, a terrible day, or maybe even this morning, regardless of how maybe, tired or depressed or life is hard or kind of attitude, at least you can be thankful that we have a God that has grace upon us and He loves you no matter what. Amen?
Amen.
Good. Well, I just wanted to kind of share, as we were taking the offering, some of you know that I've been suffering from sciatic nerve. Lord is good because the pain is gone, but the numbness is still there. I still have numbness in my right foot. No longer do I feel the pain, which is good news, but I believe the nerve is still pinched because I still can't feel feeling in my foot. Well, yesterday, for the first time, I came out to play practice football. And my wife was like, "You're getting old, just be careful." I said, "Don't worry." But somehow I always say that to my wife. I said, "Don't worry, you know." I forget that I'm 38 years old. So I'm like, so I come out to the football practice and try to hang with the young kids, you know, the young adults. Anyways, there was this one time where I was wide open and Isaac threw the ball. I was so wide open. I was so with joy. So I got the ball, and like I said, I'm still suffering from numbness in my foot. So every time I run, it feels like I'm running on just one foot. But I got so excited that I wanted to do this. I wanted to do a little shake and bake move, you know? So I think, even though nobody was there, I just wanted to do one of these moves. So I was running, and I did one of these moves, and then I literally fell flat on my face. I haven't felt like that in a long time. If you think about running full speed, doing this, and I fell, and I rolled over a couple times, and then all I hear is laughter. I was like, "Oh Lord." But I got up, and then this morning, oh my gosh, my right leg was right now on that leg. But I was getting up and said, "Man, I am getting old." Anyways, I may be getting old physically, but my heart is getting younger for the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I just feel like, you know, that's what it's about. That's what we are here. This is what we are learning in our services and with each other. This is the spirit of the fruit of the spirit. And this is the characteristics that we are supposed to be produced from the spirit. And if that's producing, we should be excited. We should be happy. We should be joyful. And the Lord says in Philippians, where Paul says, "Rejoice always." And again, I said rejoice. Now, rejoice doesn't mean, when he says that, you know, we have to understand, rejoice is not a circumstance. Right? Circumstance doesn't determine your joy. What determines your joy is how great and close and connected you are with the Lord. Right? The Lord is with you, He's going to produce that joy in you. So it doesn't matter what circumstances in your life. It doesn't matter what's going on. And the waves and the winds that are going in your life, right? If you are with the Lord, you should be joyful. It should produce joy in your heart. It should produce this joy that, man, Lord, you are all that I need. And I hope that we can continue to mature and continue to grow in that process. So let's take time to pray and let's get to our message. Father, I thank you so much for this awesome and glorifying day. Lord, we just truly want to come and just bless you, Lord. We want to come and bless your name. We sit here, Lord Father, because you call us, and we just want to return that back with our praises, with our hearts, and with our mouths, and with our lives. So, Lord, may you be blessed here today. And may you use this offering to your glory, and may the message just bring truth and challenging words. that we may continue to live this life in Christ's name. Amen. All right, so we are going on to our second to last fruit of the Spirit. And as I mentioned, the fruit of the Spirit is not many different fruits, but it's one fruit that is produced by the Spirit. So we come upon, if you want to look into the Bible, it's Galatians chapter 5. Verse 22. We are at gentleness. Gentleness. Now the word gentleness comes from the Greek word kratos. Kratos. Now some of your translation might have, well, the original translation, the King James Version, says meekness. That's the original word, meekness. Now let me ask you, what does meekness mean to you? What does meekness mean to you? Some of us might think meekness, because it rhymes with weakness, may think that it's someone that is weak. So I believe when Bible translations throughout the years, when the King James Version said meekness, some of us through this world, when people are translating, are saying, well, meekness doesn't sound too quite, you know, strong enough. So they put this word gentleness. Well, gentleness and meekness is the same thing. But even still, sometimes when you look at the Greek words, it's very hard to explain the word. I mean, it's very hard to understand the true meaning of the word. So lots of times Greek will put illustrations behind the word because, you know, sometimes you know those words that we say sometimes that doesn't really justify the meaning. And I was trying to think of an example. So I was thinking about steak. I was like, steak. And when you say steak, oh yeah, steak is good, but it doesn't really justify it. Do you actually sit in front of it and see the steak? How juicy, bloody, tender. And the word steak doesn't really like justify to you. Put steak in your mouth. All types of steaks. Filet mignon. Or I was like, ribeyes, prime rib. But that's the same thing. So basically, the Greeks will put this illustration behind the word. So the illustration behind meekness, gentleness, what they put this illustration was a horse, a wild horse that was tamed. A wild horse that was tamed. So what does it mean? Well, the world will tell you that meekness is weakness, right? In the Webster Dictionary, the meekness, it says too submissive, spiritless. This is what the world wants you to know about meekness. It's too submissive and spiritless. But the Word of God says that meekness is the fruit of the Spirit. And if it's the fruit of the Spirit, it's directly coming from God. So it shouldn't be spiritless, but it should be Spirit-filled. Amen? Meekness means power under control. There's power under control. When you think about that, when you think about a horse, a wild horse being tamed, it's ultimately later being submissive to the master. It's ultimately later obeying to the master. Even though it still has its wild side, even though it's still powerful enough to run or to whatever it wants to do, it's under control and obeying the master. A lot of theologians have definitions of meekness. Aristotle said this, that meekness is an easy tempered and easily domesticated elephant. Plato said that it describes that it's a mighty and strong beast which can be tamed and later be fed by man. Barclay said that it's like a watchdog, that who is bravely hostile to strangers and gently friendly with familiars whom he knows and loves. Do you get this picture? I hope you get this picture, that meekness is a power under control. Meekness is the rein on anger. Any man or woman can get angry and get into a fit of rage. But real power, real strength says In Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. It is a power under control. Meekness is also a strength harnessed for service. It is bringing every aspect of our being to surrender to the reigning of the Holy Spirit so that our lives will eventually bring glory to the Heavenly Father. This is what meekness should be. We see this in Jesus. We see many examples. We're going to get into it later, but we see many examples how Jesus shows meekness, power under control. Now, before I say Jesus, let me give you an example of my own. Let me ask you this question. How many of you have been in a situation where you were ultimately, it was your power that determined to do something right or to do something wrong, and eventually did the wrong way of things? You see, I think this is what kind of meekness is telling us, is that a lot of us have this power to either do something right or to do something wrong, but we eventually do the wrong. And I'll give you a little example. This story I told you for the older members here. I apologize because I'm running out of stories. But that's a lot of new people, so I want to recycle my stories. So when I was in the eighth grade, there was a sixth grader who really thought that he could beat me up. And he spread throughout the school that, yeah, David, he's too nice. He can hurt a fly. If we got to a fight, I know for sure that I could beat him up. So at first I was like, I just let it go. And this is only like sixth grade, right? What am I going to do with a sixth grade? But then he got kind of intense. Like every time he sees me, he'll come and like say, what's up, man? You know, kind of like being hard, you know? Then I was like, dude, man, just, hey, I don't want to deal with you. Just chill out. And then one day, while I was doing something, he came over and he pushed me in the back. He's like, outside, right now. He's like, are you sure? Are you for real? And I was pretty tall in eighth grade. And he was like this much shorter than me. So he was like, let's go outside, man. I said, dude, man, I don't want to. He's like, dude, he started cussing and everything. So I said, all right, let's go. So I went outside. So my whole intention was just to talk to him. Right? Just to talk to him and calm him down. Right? So we're outside, we go on the back playground, and I said, hey man, let me just tell you something. Then he turns around and he swings at me and he hits me right here in the mouth. And my whole mouth just got blood. It got, you know, like bleeding blood. And my initial thought was, what in the world is going on? So my initial thought, boom, and my hand, as soon as he hit me, my hand just went up like this. And I was like, I was like, I'm going to kill this dude. And I was like coming down as hard as I could. And I was about to hit his face. And then I just saw his face, how sorry it looked. And how much damage I could do to his face. You know, I mean, obviously this all split second, but later as I was rationalizing. Instead, as I was about to connect his face, I said, I'm going to break his jaw, do something. I said, psh. I snapped him. I went, psh. All my friends were like, what are you doing? I slapped him. I said, don't do that again. You know, and I told him, and he started crying, and you know, different things like that. And so he kind of went home. And but the whole moral story was, you know, I had the power to do the right thing. Even though he decked me, I should have not put any physical harm on him. You know, I should have hit him, and I said, dude, I still don't know. But I think a lot of us get into this situation. We know that we have the power to do the good or the bad. You know, maybe it's a situation where, you know, a family or a friend, you're in a scuffle, or you're in a confrontation, you know, or maybe you heard something about you, or you heard gossip, whatever. There's a lot of things that can make you have the power to either choose good or choose bad. And lots of times we go to the worst, we go to the bad, we react upon the circumstances, we react to things that we hear, and we get angry, we do all these different things, and ultimately later, it really hurts more than it should have been healing. So I go back to Jesus, and ultimately we know that he has the power to do a lot of things, right? I mean, Jesus is Almighty God. But take, for example, in Matthew where you know, Jesus finished praying, and then Judas brought the armies, and as they were going to arrest Jesus, Peter took his sword and he swiped at the guard, and the ear fell off. And look at what Jesus said to Peter. He said, Jesus said to him, put your sword back in its place, for all those who take up the sword shall perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will not once put my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? This is what Jesus said to Peter. He was like, dude, don't you think that I can defend myself? Don't you think that I have the power to call upon 12 legions of angels? Do you know how many 12 legions of angels is? You know what that represents, 12 legions of angels? 72,000 angels. Don't you think that I can just snap my finger, call upon 72,000 angels to defend me? Jesus had the power to do anything throughout his life. All the stories that we read, every little incident that we know about Jesus, everything that he went through from the time that he was born to the time that he was preaching to the time that he was put on death on the cross, every little single incident, he could have easily just snapped his finger and it could have been done. He didn't have to go through the suffering. He didn't have to go through the mocking. He didn't have to go through the shame. He didn't have to go through the death. He didn't have to go through the pain or all the things that he had to suffer. If all he had to do was just snap his fingers, say, Lord, take me home, and it would have been done. That's the power he had. But yet he put it under control. Gentleness as a fruit helps us to see God's perspectives. It keeps us from being too personal. It keeps us in check of our response. It makes us aware that we were once old and now we are new. And this is the reason why we've been talking over the last couple months about the attributes of the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and today gentleness. These are the attributes that God wants us to have in our lives. Why? Because those are the very attributes of God. Romans tells us that we are in the likeness of His Son. If Romans says that we are in the likeness of Jesus, that we need to exemplify these fruits in our lives. We need the Spirit to be moving and producing in our lives.
I know this is just all myself. Something did happen. I dropped some papers on that.
Gentleness is a measure of true strength and maturity in our lives. It is a sign that says that I am taking these attributes and the perspective of God so that I can glorify Him in my daily walk, in my daily life for Him. And I'm going to give you two examples of how these men exemplify gentleness. Because if you look throughout the Bible, there's only two people in the Bible that the word protos was used, the name of gentleness. The two people only. The first one was Moses. The first one in Moses. Moses was a gentle man. He was a meek man. Now you think for a second, why was Moses a meek man? Didn't Moses have anger issues? Didn't he go and he tapped the rock out of anger? But the reason why the Bible said that Moses was meek was because, think about for 40 years that he had to carry the Israelites to the promised land. For 40 years the people complained. For 40 years people said this and this and that. But yet, Moses never once complained to God. Do you even understand that even on his death, even while he was about to die, God looked at Moses and said, Moses, this is the land that I promised Abraham. Moses, I want you to look at it because you know why? You will not be able to go in it. Because because of what you did previously. But if you read, Moses didn't say, God, I can't believe I served 40 years of my life. God, I can't believe I led Jehovah, I led all the Israelites to the promised land. I'm this close, you're not going to let me even step foot in it. Moses never complained. He just simply been submissive to God's will. See, meekness is submissive to God's will. And the second thing, the second example that the word great gentleness comes in is by the example of Jesus Christ. Now, I gave you an example of Jesus Christ by his power. Now, I want to look at what Jesus' example with other people. Because gentleness must be bestowed unto other people. When the fruit of the spirit of gentleness is in us, we must be gentle toward other people. Now we're going to look at a couple stories of Jesus and how he did this. The first example comes in John chapter 4. John chapter 4. It is Jesus and the woman at the well. Now, I'm not going to read the whole thing because it's kind of quite long. But we know the story. We know the basic story about the woman at the well. You know, Jesus came and as his disciples went to get food. If you look at verse 8, it's kind of funny. Like when you look at verse 7, it says, a woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me drink. In verse 8, it says, for his disciples had gone away to the city to buy food. That's a whole verse in itself. Now, in parentheses, I wonder why, you know, the Bible mentioned that disciples went to go buy food. And I heard one commentary said this, which I thought was pretty cool and appropriate, was that the reason why they mentioned this, because if the disciple was there with Jesus, then this conversation with the woman probably wouldn't have generated. If the disciple was there, they probably would have said, Jesus, what are you doing talking to the Samaritan woman? You know we're not supposed to be talking with her. So that's why I believe that in verse 8 it says that the disciples went to get food, and it was just Jesus and the woman. Jesus and the woman. And we know the woman said, oh, you're a Jew, you should be talking to me. And Jesus, you know, back in the culture, the Jewish people really despised the people of Samaria. Because they felt that they were unclean. They were like, a lot of them were like, as the term, half-breeds. So they thought that they were not worthy enough. So they were really looked down upon in society. Not only that, they're not allowed to talk to men. You know, even today, that culture still stands. I teach on Mondays at university up in Maryland. And one of my class has two Middle Eastern, Islam, things like that. The woman always wears a veil on her head. And I remember the first day I met her, I was like, oh, that's the news. And I stuck my hand, and I said, no. You know, I was like, oh. He's like, I must not touch men. You know? I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, so she was really good. So, being naive that I am, I said, oh, so what happens if you have to go see a doctor? And she was like, yes, I tried to, best I can, to meet a woman doctor. I was like, that's interesting. And she kind of explained that. Because like, I had this idea of, what if you're pregnant? And there's no female doctors, and then you had a male doctor to give you birth. And she was very open. She kind of explained that. In that case, that it's okay, Allah will forgive it. So she was kind of going around, I was like, that's pretty interesting. So at that point, I was like, wow, there's even that culture today still stands. But going back to the story, we see that, Jesus said, hey, I can give you eternal living water. And the Samaritan woman was like, oh, where can I get this water? And so on. You see the conversation goes on, and towards the end, you see Jesus says, go tell your husband. And the woman said, well, I don't have anybody to tell. And Jesus said, that's right. You have five. You have five husbands that you should have. Right? So basically, the whole story behind it is that basically, Jesus could easily condemn that woman for the sin that she was living. Jesus could easily say, you have been going around and you had five husbands to this point, and he could have just really torn her apart and really condemned her seriously. But yet, Jesus, in his wisdom, directed a different way by saying, listen, it doesn't matter what sin that you fell in. What matters is that I can give you that living water. Not only in John chapter 4, but we look at John chapter 8 about the woman caught in adultery. You know, we also see that incident where the Pharisees and Sadducees, they were find everything they could to trap Jesus. They find everything they could to accuse Jesus, right? So basically what they thought was, hey, there's this adulterous woman that's been sleeping around. Maybe we can catch her. Maybe we can catch her in that. Because if you look in chapter 8, if you read that verse, you'll see it. That says that in the morning, the Pharisee caught this woman in adultery. That's kind of fun when you read it, because every time it's like, wow, in the morning, they caught this woman in the very act. You know, I was always trying to think about that for a second. Like, man, what was these Pharisees doing, stalking? You know, like how in the world do they know that this woman is doing such and such in the morning? Well, so kind of like my humanistic mind will think like, maybe they searched and found this woman. Maybe they say, oh, there's this woman that comes at this certain time every morning and does this, and it's being unfaithful. So these Pharisees, they stake out. And when they see this woman, they come and they bust down the door and they take this woman. And when they say they're an act, it's very crazy because, you know, she's out, she's naked. So they drag her naked body out to Jesus, right? And then we see the Pharisee says, Jesus, we caught this woman in adultery. What do you say? See, what the Pharisees wanted Jesus to do, they're trying to put Jesus into a trap, right? Because if Jesus would have said, I want you to stone her to death, then what Jesus was doing was going above Roman authority, Roman government. And Jews didn't have authority to put people to death. Which means if Jesus had put her to death, then the Romans could have easily came and arrested Jesus. But if Jesus said, let her go, then the Pharisees would say, well, the law of Moses says that if anyone's caught in adultery, we're going to stone her. So these Pharisees are like, yes, we caught Jesus in the very act. Yes, we can get him to say these things, we can accuse him of. And they're all excited. But let me tell you, if you read the story, you never hear the mention of where the man went. Because in the law of Moses says that if a man or a woman is caught, both of them must come out to be stoned. So the man wasn't even there. I just totally don't know why. I know the Pharisees were like, tell the man, why don't you just get out of here? You don't just go live your life. But what does Jesus do? What does Almighty Jesus do? Do you think Jesus had the power to do anything, right? But in his gentle spirit, in his gentleness, Jesus stoops down on the ground. He begins to doodle in the dirt. I love this man. He's just doodling in the dirt. And the Pharisees are looking and said, if you ever want to get somebody mad, more mad, if somebody's coming to you angry, this is not him. Why are you smiling at? They didn't get more angry. It's like, that's how Jesus was. He was like doodling in it. The Pharisees, if you read it again, ask the question again. Jesus, we said this woman was caught in adultery. And then Jesus stands up. He goes, those without sin in your life, be the first one to go to the stone. Oh, man, what a wise statement. And then Jesus goes back and starts doodling again on the floor. You know, a lot of commentaries kind of put their take on that. What was Jesus doodling on the thing? Because Bible never explained why, you know, what Jesus was writing. But some people thought that Jesus was writing like 10 commandments, you know. Some people thought that Jesus was writing like, you know, all the sins. I like that. I believe that Jesus was saying like, Pharisee number one, lusted after the woman. Pharisee number two, lusted after Pharisee one. Anyways, you know, but I don't know what he was wrote, but I could feel that he was really striking to the hearts of those people. And here's the idea behind the story, behind that example is when Jesus said, you be the first one without the sin to throw the stone, he knew that everybody that was standing there were men, all had lustful desires at one point in their lives. All had sexual desires at one point in their lives. So one by one, from young to old, they all dropped their stones, and they couldn't throw the stone. Man, and look at the gentle spirit of Jesus again. He's sitting there, and he looks at the woman. The woman, can you imagine, being shameful, being naked, being humiliated. I can just see her trying to cover herself up, shaking. And the gentle spirit of Jesus says, looks at the woman and says, does anyone condemn you? She said, no.
And Jesus says, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. That's a gentle spirit. Listen, I don't condemn you. I forgive you. I love you. Go and sin no more. And you see, right after, you see Jesus tell the crowd that I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. So we see these examples. And we see in Luke chapter 19, Zacchaeus, who was a tax collector, wanted to see Jesus. And we see that the people started to grumble when they heard Jesus say to Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house so that I can have dinner with you. The people began to grumble. Why? Because tax collector back in those days were considered to be the worst occupation. Because tax collectors were usually Jewish people. And what Jewish people will do, these tax collectors will go to the other fellow Jewish people and take their money. And they were considered to be hypocrites in those days. They were disliked upon. So even the worst type of people, the people disliked, Jesus had a gentle spirit. Loved them and wanted to be around them. And I think this is an example that you and I need to have in our Christian walk, is to be gentle with one another. Paul says it in his letters. Paul says it in Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. He says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. In Ephesians 4, 1 verses 1 through 3 says, I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. So what these two verses are telling us, in our gentle spirit. One of the things that we must do, if you look at the stories, these three stories, you see that Jesus always points out the sin of people's lives. And see, what we have to realize as believers in the church, as members of this church, those who call ourselves to be the sons and daughters of God, we are to look out for one another. We are to look out for each other. And if there's a sin in our lives, if there's something that's keeping us from the relationship of Jesus Christ, we are to be there in a gentle spirit and to correct. Well, I don't want to use the word correct, but encourage one another. You see, this verse tells us a couple things. That it's the goal is always restoration and not retaliation. Why? So that we can maintain a unity in the body of Christ. You see, what Jesus exemplifies in these stories is that we need each other to grow. We need people, brothers and sisters, who are spiritual. This is what Paul says. Those who are more spiritual, to come to those who are suffering in their walks with in Christ and say, brother and sister, this is what you need to work on. But in a gentle spirit. And see, this is where it gets hard. See, a lot of us are so used to, our human nature is so used to just condemning. We see somebody sinning, we see somebody, and it's so easy for us. The first thing that most people probably do is get with other Christians and brothers and says, man, this dude is sinning, man. This girl, whatever, is doing it. What happens? When you do that, you begin to gossip. And once you start to gossip that one person, Satan will love to feast upon that. So what the Bible tells us is that those who are spiritual, those who are mature, to go to one of these brothers and sisters who are living a life that is damaging to them, we are responsible to talk and to be gentle and to encourage them to be bright back on. This is what Jesus did in those stories. He told the Samaritan woman, yes, I know you lied about your husband. You have five of them. But that's fine. That's not fine. I forgive you.
Because I am the eternal life. I am the living water. I can forgive you. Right? The story of the woman, adultery. I condemned you not. But go and sin no more. This is what Jesus says. He says, go and sin no more to the woman. You understand that verse, go sin no more? It's kind of, what do you call those? What kind of question is that? A question to fail? Was that? How can we sin no more? I mean, we're sinners. We're always going to sin. So what does Jesus say? Go sin no more. It's almost like a statement for us to fail. No, when Jesus said, go sin no more, you know what he was replying there? He was replying to that woman, listen, woman, you have a problem with adultery. You have a problem with being unfaithful. You have a problem with lustful desires. That sin, go do no more. Go and find victory over that. Go find victory over pornography. Go find victory over anger. Go find victory over lying. Go find victory over gossiping. Go find victory over anything that you can think of that is sinful. And what Satan wants you to do, this is what Jesus says, that we are to find victory one by one. And we can do that. We can find ourselves finding victory over little things that have conquered us. If we find time in prayer, in the Word of God, and with fellowship with other brothers and sisters in Christ. Not only are we to, with believers, have a gentle spirit, but the Bible tells us that we are to be gentle with those that are not believers, those that are opponents, those that are our enemies. 2 Timothy 2, 24-26 says, and the Lord's servants must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil and be captured by him to do his will. So we as Christians, we are to be gentle to those who do not know the love of Christ. You know, I know a lot of people out there will go out and say, you're going to hell! I mean, I have nothing against fire and brimstone. I think fire and brimstone is not necessary. But with the message of Jesus Christ, with the gospel of Jesus Christ, we need to be gentle with it. This is what the Bible says. To be gentle in the spirit. When we're talking about Jesus to people who don't know who Jesus is. Think for a moment. If you were met with somebody that was yelling in your face and you were going to hell, how much of you would say, listen, yes, I ain't going to hell yet. It's not going to happen. You're going to be like, what's wrong with you? Get out of my face. And you're doing more damage to the gospel. We see it in today's society. On March 20th, this guy named Pastor Jerry Jones of the Dove Outreach World Center, I don't know if you remember this, but he got together and he collected all the Muslim books and all the Quran and decided to have a burning of the book day. And he thought that this was going to be a great thing. It caused more damage, it caused more hurt, it caused more killing in the Muslim countries. It set out a whole riot. And who can ever forget the Westboro Baptist Church? That every time a soldier dies, they're out there with their sign saying, vicious, hurtful words. This is not the way God intended us Christians to be. He wanted us all to have a gentle, kind, loving spirit. And in no way am I condemning or trying to water down the truth. I think it's important for us to understand the sinful nature and the sinfulness that we all live in. But with like every aspect of the fruit, the love, the joy, the peace, the kindness, the goodness, the faithfulness, and now gentleness, we have to understand the primary concern of those things is for other people. How we develop this fruit so that we can be an example for Christ to those people that don't have it. I end with the Proverbs. Proverbs 15, 1 through 4. Now listen to what it says. It says, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise commands knowledge, but the mouth of the fool pour out folly. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. A gentle tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks spirit. Proverbs 15, 1 through 4. My question is to you today, have you betrayed the fruits of the Spirit? Have you allowed the Spirit to be moving in your heart? The Spirit reviving in your heart through prayer and reading God's Word? Spending meditating with the Lord so that these fruits can come out of you? When was the last time, or when's the last time that you think that you had a gentle spirit? That you had meekness? That you had the power to control the situation? But yet you did the opposite and abused the power that you were given. My challenge is this week, and I believe that you will be challenged. Every week we are challenged. Every day we are challenged. Every moment of our lives, we are always battling the spiritual warfare that is going on in our lives. There are today demons and angels fighting for your soul. Which side are you going to feed more? Are you going to feed the side of Satan and his enemies? Or are you going to obey and sacrifice and live a glorifying life for Jesus Christ? It's our choice. It's our choice. Which side are you going to be on? So this week, once again, I challenge you to keep reading the fruit of the Spirit. Keep saying to yourself, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Keep repeating that and say, Lord, the Spirit, produce this fruit in me. So that when I do come into these situations, that I am able to show love, that I am able to show joy, that I am able to show peace. That no matter what kind of situation that I'm in, that I'm able to always think about others than myself. And I'm always able to give kindness and goodness and gentleness to those that need that in their lives. Or are we going to be selfish and say, you know what? I'm hurt. And I had a bad day. And I'm not sure. It's not the way to live. It's not what we need to think of others before ourselves. And that's the commandment in the Bible. Think others before yourself. That's the great commandment. Love the Lord God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And the second, to love your neighbors. Then love yourself. So I want you to take time right now, and as you're going to prayer, to think of someone. Think of someone that you know that needs your forgiveness. Maybe you've done something wrong. Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's a friend. Maybe it's a schoolmate. So what if it's their fault? So what if they're the ones that have done you wrong? That's what gentleness is. So no matter what they've done wrong to you, you are the Christian. You are the one who's supposed to be a child of God. You're the one to still say, I still love you no matter what. I still love you no matter what. And I am going to show my gentle spirit because the spirit in me is producing that. It's not about my own strength. If it was all my own strength, I would be mad at you too. But no, it's the spirit that's living in me. And it's because I love my Lord Jesus Christ. And that is why I have this gentle spirit that's producing in me to love you better.
This is what God wants us to do. Let's pray.